Hello, and welcome to another episode of Limitless Palette. In this series, my goal is to provide you lots of information about painting with a split primary limited palette. And while normally that includes my six basic paints from Daniel Smith that I teach about in my Craftsy class, I also wanted to address something that many of my students ask me about, and that is when you've already purchased or have been gifted a set of watercolors, how do you make those work for you with a split primary limited palette? And then the other question I often get is, what colors do I add next? And the thing is about a split primary limited palette is that those six core colors, which are a warm and cool version of red, yellow, and blue, are wonderful for learning basic color theory and color mixing as artists. And they are not the only colors we will use as watercolorists, but it's really a great idea to start with less and how, you know, to learn how to use those really well and then add other colors in as we need them. So today I'm using a set of watercolors that I purchased from Sennelier. It is a wonderful value. It comes in this beautiful wooden box. And I purchased it from Jackson's Art Supply. I believe it was about $115. And for that, I got this beautiful wooden box, all of these pigments here. And then it also came with this porcelain mixing palette, which is very, very handy. And it came with two brushes. One of those is a size 3/0 squirrel mop, which is almost identical to my squirrel mop that I use frequently by Isabey. I'm pretty sure that this brush was made by Isabey. I mean, they are almost identical. And it also came with a number 2 pointed round sable brush that says Sennelier on it. And I removed that brush and I keep in here my number 8 Escoda versatile pointed round. I love this brush. It's great for travel. It is a synthetic fiber, but it acts very much like a sable brush. So that is the one that I replaced the number 2 round with. And I'm just going to put that back and use the brush, that one of the brushes that it came with. So as you can see, this set comes with many, many colors. And the first thing I do when I look at a set like this is I decide what my core split primary palette is within this set of watercolor pigments. So I'm going to start by showing you those pigments. And my first that I will show you is the cool yellow, which in this set is called lemon yellow. And it's really perfect. It is a bright, clear, cool lemon yellow. I would say it's semi-transparent, which is pretty average for a cool yellow watercolor pigment. It's really hard to find one that's totally transparent. So it will work great for my purposes. The next one is my warm yellow, and in this set, it happens to be Indian yellow. And it is also fairly transparent and a perfect warm yellow hue. So those two, I'm all set. The next one that I look for is a warm red. And that is where this set fails me. The only choice really for a warm red is called French vermilion. And I would say this color is semi-opaque. You see how it goes on the paper, pretty strong and opaque. It is a warm red. It's warm toward neutral, I would say. It is not ideal for me. So what I would do with this set is I would remove the French vermilion from this pan, and I would squeeze some of my Daniel Smith transparent pyrrole orange to replace it. I would fill the pan with that color, and then I would be good to go. I do this often. I have never found a better warm red for my purposes. So that pigment that I almost always use is Daniel Smith transparent pyrrole orange. It's different than regular pyrrole orange. It's more of a tomatoey red color, and you've seen me use it in other videos. So for my cool red, I have a few options here, but the one I think that works the best for me is called Carmine. And it is, I believe, right here. That is quinacridone red. It's this one. So this is called Carmine. And it is not PV19, which is permanent rose or quinacridone rose, but it is a really nice kind of cool red. Okay. The other option I have in here is called Opera Rose. Opera Rose is a very fugitive color. It's not even rated on the light fast scale. Okay, but you can see it's a very cool red. I could use that to maybe adjust my cool red if I ever needed to, but I don't think I will. And I can show you my main test for a cool red. And that is basically how it reacts with ultramarine blue to make a violet. So if I put a little bit of the carmine in my palette and I mix some of the ultramarine blue with it, I get a fairly vibrant color, and I'm happy with that. Okay, if I wanted to make it more vibrant, I could add just a touch of that opera rose, and it's going to give me a little bit more of the violet hue I'm looking for. So for my purposes, I would stick with the carmine as my replacement for the permanent rose within this set. Now for blues, I'm really well off. I have French ultramarine blue for my warm blue, and they include phthalocyanine blue, for a cool blue. And those are absolutely perfect, exactly what I would choose from my Daniel Smith palette or Winsor & Newton or anything else. So I've got all of the components of my split primary palette here, and that is great. So again, I would definitely switch out my warm red, but in a pinch this would do. And the problem with it being opaque is that when I'm using it as my standard mixing color, I don't want to over mix it and to have it get muddy. So I usually have better luck with transparent pigments if I'm painting anything other than really light washes. So that's why I would switch it. Now I have all of these other colors here to experiment with and to add to these core mixing colors. And I'm going to go through those and kind of show you what else comes with this palette. So they also include a color called Naples Yellow Deep. And Naples Yellow is a color that I do use. It is very similar to a yellow ochre, maybe not quite as dark. And I tend to use it a lot in landscape paintings where I want to paint field grasses or things like that. It is a beautiful color. I don't tend to mix too much into it. I really use it as it is, but it's a very, very useful color. The next one is called Bright Red, and it is a fairly transparent red, a very neutral red, and would be really useful. They also include a color called Venetian Red, which is one of my favorite earth pigment colors. It's fairly opaque, but what's beautiful about Venetian Red is that it granulates just in a lovely way. I do sometimes mix it with other colors, and I tend to use it more masked out with lots of water, so I get this kind of pale, earthy, peachy pink color that I really like to enhance clouds in landscape paintings. So that is a really beautiful color. It's also handy for urban sketching, for things like brickwork on old buildings. So it is a lovely color to have in the palette. And then after that, they include alizarin crimson. And while alizarin crimson is a beautiful, beautiful pigment that many, many artists use, I tend not to use it at all. And the main reason for that is because it is a very fugitive pigment, and I know that over time, if I frame my watercolors and I want them to last a long time, alizarin crimson will tend to change in hue. It'll turn a little bit grayer and it will fade over time. So I just ignore that pigment, and I might even take it out and replace it with something else that I use more often, like perhaps cobalt turquoise. So that's my alizarin crimson. Then we have a carmine. And then they include quinacridone red, which is a lovely color for any mixing purposes. It's very transparent. It's kind of a coral red, and I do really like that. I also have, I also have the opera rose, which I already talked about. Okay, I wouldn't use it too often, maybe for some glazing work. If I were painting pink flowers or something. And then they include cobalt violet light hue, which for me is a really, really useful color. I use that quite often for many purposes. It is semi-opaque. You do have to keep that in mind, but it is a lovely hue. I use it fairly washed out. They also include a lovely deep purple, purple dioxazine, which is fairly standard. Winsor & Newton makes one, they call it Winsor Violet, but this is a great purple to have in the palette. And then we get into the blues. We've already talked about the French Ultramarine and the Phthalo Blue. The next one is called Cinerous Blue. And I really love this color. It's cool, like a phthalo blue, but it does granulate quite a bit. And what I like to use this color for is for winter skies. And I can mix it with just a touch of burnt sienna to gray it out and achieve like this beautiful light, you know, steely winter sky color. It's gorgeous on the paper. It does nice blooms and granulation. The next colors we get into are the greens, and they include three greens. The first one they call forest green. It's fairly dark. I would say it's semi-transparent. Okay, not very useful on its own, but if I want to use it as a convenience color, I would probably warm it up a little bit with my warm yellow. So adding a transparent pigment in there so I could get sort of a warmer green. And I can also, let me just make that a little bit darker. Gray it out a little bit more by adding some red to it. So I could add even a touch of carmine to it. And it's gonna give me a more natural looking green, okay? They also include Viridian, which is one of my favorite pigments. Not so much for the color. It's a beautiful color, but I love the properties of Viridian. And I love that it masses out to this beautiful sort of aquamarine color, and I use that a lot as a glaze. Believe it or not, I use it very often on chickadee wings, their upper wings. When I put a glaze of Viridian on top, it's just the perfect shade. Over the brown. So Viridian is very useful to me. And then they also include something called Phthalo Green Light, which is a really, really transparent, very warm yellow green. Okay, so those are the greens. And then they get into yellow ochre, which is a standard earth pigment. It's very similar to the Naples yellow, but a little bit more on the neutral side. Okay, also very, very handy for landscape painting. And then there is burnt sienna, which is a standard. And I use burnt sienna, gosh, and just seems like just about every painting. And the most common thing I use it for is to create beautiful grays with blues. So if I use some French ultramarine and I add just a touch of burnt sienna to it, I can gray it out. Add a little bit more pigment here and get sort of a gray blue, and if I add even more, I get a beautiful, beautiful gray color that's very transparent and has lovely granulation properties. So burnt sienna is super, super convenient. They also include Payne's Gray, which is another color that I use a lot, and their Payne's Gray is really lovely. It's a gorgeous kind of black blue. Also great when I mass it out a little bit for a winter sky. Has nice granulation properties. Next, they include a color called Warm Sepia, which is a dark brown. Also very handy. I use this color quite a bit also. It's gorgeous with the Payne's Gray. They include Raw Umber, which is a very useful earth pigment. It's a little bit warmer than sepia, a little bit lighter. I can even add a little more to show you how dark this sepia can actually get. So raw umber is very, very useful. And then they include ivory black. Now, I don't use ivory black hardly ever, but every now and then it is handy to use on its own. I don't tend to use it as a mixing color at all. It tends to make things muddy pretty quickly. So those are the colors that this set comes with. Again, really, really useful for certain applications. I'm not going to use all of these colors as my standard mixing palette, but What I often do is choose the colors that I'll be using from my core split primary palette, and I add maybe one, two, or three other colors that I think will enhance my painting. So again, it's really, really useful to have many paints. Not great to try to learn with them all at once, but if you have a set like this, what I suggest is taking a black Sharpie marker and making a thick black line on a piece of watercolor paper. Let it dry completely, and then swatch out the colors that you consider the warm and cool yellow, the warm and cool red, and the warm and cool blue, and see which ones are transparent, okay? And then choose those for your mixing palette. Chances are your warm red is going to be where you're going to have the most trouble. And if that is true, you can always replace it with a Daniel Smith transparent pyrrole orange. So I hope this was helpful to you. I hope that you can see that even when we have a large array of watercolors already, there is always a way to try to find our split primary colors within that palette, and we can always use the other colors to enhance our paintings. Thanks a lot for being here. You can subscribe to the channel for the latest updates on all my new videos. I will have a Watercolour Wednesday up in a couple days. Thanks so much. Bye-bye. Once again, thank you so much for joining me, and I hope you'll subscribe to my channel for all the latest updates.